Well, thank you, Mr. President. I was a delegate to Washington Council of Police and Sheriffs from about 1992 until I retired from the Spokane Police Department in 2006. And many times the things that people would assume that we were agreeing to or being part of when it came to legislation scared us. And so rather than confronting bad policy, we attempted to mitigate bad policy by involving ourselves. The policy ultimately is made better than it was before, but it was still bad policy. One of the aspects that we find that we do here on the floor as an academic discussion is we find something that is a current set of rules or laws, and maybe the appearance is that people aren't following them, or just ignoring them. And so how do we fix it here? Hey, let's make it even more illegal. Everything we're talking about in this bill, everything we're talking about is currently addressed by the canons of ethics of the departments out there. This is model code that's been talked about for 25 years now. I'm painfully aware because these are things addressed in the course of change in working conditions, you know, subject to collective bargaining. I know, I was there, I was on the other side. They're addressed by internal affairs with each individual department. They saw these things that were wrong. If somebody's should have acted when they didn't, did act when they shouldn't, if there's people around there who are witnesses to it, they investigated and they came up with counseling, remedial training, discipline. The real issue here is everybody has constantly had that mantra of, you know, there's just a couple of bad eggs in the department and we want to protect the good guys. The problem is when you say you don't trust the departments or the administrations or the internal affairs groups of the departments as a whole, you're saying all cops are corrupt. You can't trust any of them. So we need to have a complete separate investigation process out here from a complete separate agency that we're going to vest authority to oversee this. And that just flies in the face of what we're saying about most cops being good and being trustworthy. We're questioning the validity of the system, the credibility of the system here. You know, 15 years as a detective out of the 22 I did a lot of different stuff as a detective. One of the things you find is you may have all five people in the front row here. They can see identical incident right here in front of you, Mr. President. And I'll go to interview them 24 hours later. And I'll get five completely different statements as to what happened directly in front of them. That's not the exception. That's a standardized response. You try and differentiate between what they're saying as to their perspective, their context, their paradigm. So just because you have one police officer's perspective on an issue doesn't mean that's going to be another police officer's perspective on an issue. We've done some things here that scare me because we tend to do that on a regular basis. We've postured some very, very bad acting officers in some anecdotal moments that were publicized on video and replayed in perpetuity about bad actors that really make the rest of the law enforcement cadre look bad. That is taking something at a one-dimensional elementary level and inductively applying something to all cops out there and fomenting policy based on the actions of a couple of bad actors out there and putting everybody at risk as a result. This bill is doing exactly that. It's going in the wrong direction. So Senator Short, Senator Wagner, both tried to put some amendments up that just clarified issues here. Because we all know, everybody knows here, it doesn't matter what your perspective is, what your position is, that if there's potential for abuse somewhere in statute, even about 3-4 years, somebody will figure out exactly how to use it. The definitions they're looking for here had to do with excessive force, had to do with wrongdoing, and had to do with intervention. I love that intervention. I read this bill 3-4 times, all a couple of paragraphs of it. An intervention is just standalone. You know, you could have an intervention in, is somebody that's alcoholic. Well, we're going to use family pressure. We're going to get them into treatment. You can have intervention when you have somebody that's in a cult. You're going to kidnap them. You're going to take, what exactly does that mean? If you have somebody that's in a deadly force situation, if you talk to them, say, don't shoot them, is that intervening? Are you supposed to shoot him? Is that intervention? Are you supposed to tackle him? I mean, exactly what is the total scale and what response is required here? Funny part is, it's subjective and in the eye of the beholder. When somebody acts in a split-second decision, and they've got 6 months to a year to look over this over a period of time and dissect it. You know, I sat there on a Monday morning after the Super Bowl and yelled at Brady because he waited too long to pass a bunch of times. You know, I've never played quarterback. I played baseball. I don't know a darn thing about what he's doing, especially at that level. But we all have an opinion. We have a context. We have a perspective. You're putting police officers in that situation here. Armchair quarterbacks can come in and address this very issue. Look, a policy is needed here. Yes, a policy change is needed. But this vehicle is so fraught with potential for political abuse, for misapplication of terms, misinterpretation of terms, or the potential to be that the sin is in the eye of the beholder of what happened. I really wish we would have passed that last amendment and given us some time to kind of vet this and get this whole thing structured so it had some utility, rather than just being something that, on top of everything else, scares cops. I look at this, and these are the kind of things that I would have never gone into being in law enforcement had I seen any of these things in place, had any idea what it was 35 years ago. It's just that these are the things that are so dissuasive to somebody to wanting to participate in this. And I'll give you a context. Yes, we're the lowest number of police officers per 1,000 in this state and the country, all well and fine. Show me another job out there where you can make $100,000 a year at age 25 with a couple of humanities credits and a benefits package you can't get anywhere else, and we can't get people to take the job. What are we missing here? This is an absolutely terrible bill. Put it down.